Thank you, my former boss and the chairperson, former chairperson of the African Union Commission. I thank Madam Moon, Dr. Walsh, Dr. Taj Hamad for inviting me to this very important conference, very successful so far, and also for their generosity. The title is Peace, Security, and Human Development in Africa. And if there is one continent in which there is that linkage between peace, security, and human development, I think it's Africa. All the challenges are there, but also the opportunities. And that's why I would like to begin by saying that while Africa has achieved much progress in leaving behind the shadows of its colonial past and in promoting the development and democratization of the continent, it continues to grapple with ways to end violent conflicts with their devastating record of deaths, sufferings, and displacement of civilian population. I know, because I have direct experience. I've just ended last July my tenure as the head of the Joint African Union United Nations mission in Darfur, where as a result of that conflict, hundreds of thousands of people have died and more than 2 million people have been displaced. African leaders are grappling with continued widespread underdevelopment and poverty in addition to trying to end these conflicts. And we also observe that conflicts in the 21st century, in the world in general, but Africa in particular, are characterized by their multidimensional nature and complex causes, such as inequality, state collapse and failure, political, economic, and social marginalization, scarcity of resources, human rights violations, environmental degradation, and others. Because these conflicts are complex, there are no easy or simple solutions. Also, to make the situation even more challenging, most conflicts in Africa today are intrastate conflicts, but with considerable regional and international implications and involvement. So when you talk about Darfur, you are talking about not just Darfur, Sudan, but the entire region. When you talk about Mali, you are talking about the Sahel, the conflict there. And also, you have conflicting interests of rebel groups fighting the government, as well as, in some instances, other non-state actors, terrorist networks around the globe. They become involved in a number of conflicts in Africa, from the Sahel region all the way to the Somali coast. So such conflicts cannot be addressed solely by just prevention, preventive diplomacy, political negotiations, peacemaking, or even peacekeeping, or the use of force. Nor can they be resolved through national actions alone. What is needed is an integrated and comprehensive yet coherent approach, which includes, in addition to political, military activities, transparent and urgent improvements in the areas of environmental protection, human rights, good governance, democratization, economic growth, and poverty alleviation. That is where the human development dimension comes in. The first Global Human Development Report was launched by the UN in 1990 and defined human development as being about engaging people's freedoms and choices and capabilities. In fact, it was based on the assumption that when human development advances, people live longer and lead healthier lives. They are better educated, have more income, and can live in greater dignity. But unfortunately, how to get from here to there in terms of human development in the context of proliferation of conflicts that are a lot more complex, whose solutions are not simple, is the real challenge. But there's been some progress. You've had, at the UN level, the Agenda for Peace and Development. You have the OECD Development Assistance Committee Guidelines on Conflict, Peace and Development Cooperation, and numerous government and intergovernmental policy statements reflect the change in thinking. Similarly, the African Union, of which Dr. Pinga has just left the position of chairman of the commission, also have something that is unique called African Peer Review Mechanism, which is to promote good governance, democracy, economic governance, corporate governance, and social economic development. The purpose of the mechanism is to encourage conformity in regards to political, economic, and corporate governance values, codes, and standards among African countries, and the objectives in the social economic development within the new Partnership for Africa's Development. Similarly, in 2006, the African Union developed a draft policy framework on post-conflict reconstruction and development, which is conceived as a tool to consolidate peace, prevent a relapse of violence, help address the root causes of conflict, encourage fast-track planning and implementation of reconstruction, and enhance complementarity and coordination between diverse actors. Unfortunately, however, the implementation of this framework is being hampered because the African Union has to deal with so many conflicts at once. Darfur, Somalia, Mali, DRC, and a number of issues. So that's why I want to move now to look at recommendations and the way forward. The real challenge is to design better informed, more comprehensive conflict management strategies, including the various actors involved, so as to, and I cannot overemphasize this, to address the root causes of conflict, not just to address the manifestation of the conflicts in the continent. So conflict prevention mechanisms and strategies are important, but more than that, we have to look at a holistic approach to translate down to a practical level, because there are so much difficulties in handling piecemeal the various dimensions of conflict in Africa, or even to separate one conflict from another. Also, civil society, local ownership is very important. And above all, promoting inclusive development across all communities and parts of societies, including especially women, youth, and the elderly. Women, because as a result of the conflicts in Africa and elsewhere, who suffers the most from these conflicts is the women and the children. So they have to be involved in finding solutions to conflicts in the continent. And also the youths. Yesterday we heard about the statistics about youth unemployment in several developing countries, particularly in Africa. Now, if you don't keep the youths properly employed, what happens? They fall into the wrong hands. They become tools of recruitment as child soldiers and to do very negative things. Then also we need coherence and complementarity through increased coordination and cooperation among the intervening actors, the donors, peacekeeping missions, implementing agencies, and NGOs in all stages of the intervention. Efforts, of course, are underway. To promote these synergies and complementarity at the UN level, delivering as one. But this is more in theory than in reality. In conclusion, I would like to suggest that what we need to do is go beyond humanitarian assistance and really go to medium-term and long-term efforts in order to end conflicts in the continent, and also address the nexus between peace, security, and development. The former United Nations Secretary General Kofi Annan noted, and I quote, and this is going to be my last half a minute, human security encompasses human rights, good governance, access to education and healthcare, and ensuring that each individual has opportunities and choices to fulfill his or her own potential. Every step in this direction is also a step towards reducing poverty, achieving economic growth, preventing conflict. Freedom from want, freedom from fear, and freedom of future generations to inherit a healthy natural environment, these are the interrelated blocks of human and therefore national security. Promoting sustainable peace therefore requires a human security and human development orientation and high-level political commitment and coordinated public policy initiative will, in my view, play a critical role in overcoming continuing challenges to the nexus of peace, security, and human development, particularly in Africa. Thank you very much for listening.